learn what is the best way to achieve that defined objective. Let's start off with an example. We've all played hide and seek as kids. But what happens when you ask artificial intelligence, AI agents, to play the same game? So there are two teams, Team Red, who are the seekers, and Team Blue, who are the hiders. The AI agents were given only the set of the rules of the game and the final objective. That is all. The strategies that they came up with will absolutely blow your mind away. Let's take a look.
In this project, OpenAI built a hide-and-seek game for their AI agents to play. While we look at the exact rules here, I will note that the goal of the project was to pit two AI teams against each other and hopefully see some interesting emergent behaviors. And boy, did they do some crazy stuff. The coolest part is that the two teams compete against each other, and whenever one team discovers a new strategy, the other one has to adapt. And the results are magnificent, amusing, weird. You'll see in a moment. These agents learn from previous experiences, and to the surprise of no one, for the first few million rounds, we start out with pandemonium. Everyone just running around aimlessly. Without proper strategy and semi-random movements, the seekers are favored and hence win the majority of the games. Nothing to see here. Then, over time, the hiders learned to lock out the seekers by blocking the doors off with these boxes and started winning consistently. I think the coolest part about this is that the map was deliberately designed by the OpenAI scientists in a way that the hiders can only succeed through collaboration. They cannot win alone, and hence they are forced to learn to work together, which they did quite well. But then, something happened. Did you notice this pointy, doorstop-shaped object? Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Well, probably, and not only that, but about 10 million rounds later, the AI also discovered that it can be pushed near a wall and be used as a ramp, and ta-da! Got him. The seeker started winning more again. So, the ball is now back on the court of the hiders. Can you defend this? If so, how? Well, these resourceful little critters learned that since there is a little time at the start of the game when the seekers are frozen, apparently, during this time, they cannot see them, so why not just sneak out, steal the ramp, and lock it away from them? Absolutely incredible. Look at those happy eyes as they are carrying that ramp. And you think it all ends here? No, no, no. Not even close. It gets weirder. Much weirder. When playing a different map, a seeker has noticed that it can use a ramp to climb on the top of a box, and this happens. Do you think couch surfing is cool? Give me a break. This is box surfing. And the scientists were quite surprised by this move, as this was one of the first cases where the seeker AI seems to have broken the game. What happens here is that the physics system is coded in a way that they are able to move around by exerting force on themselves, but there is no additional check whether they are on the floor or not, because who in their right mind would think about that? As a result, something that shouldn't ever happen does happen here. And we are still not done yet, this paper just keeps on giving. A few hundred million rounds later, the hiders learned to separate all the ramps from the boxes. Dear fellow scholars, this is proper box surfing defense. Then, lock down the remaining tools and build a shelter. Note how well rehearsed and executed this strategy is. There is not a second of time left until the seekers take off. I also love this cheeky move where they set up the shelter right next to the seekers, and I almost feel like they are saying, yeah, see this here? There's not a single thing you can do about it. In a few isolated cases, other interesting behaviors also emerged. For instance, the hiders learned to exploit the physics system and just chuck the ramp away. After that, the seekers go, what? What just happened? But don't despair, and at this point, I would also recommend that you hold on to your papers, because there was also a crazy case where a seeker also learned to abuse a similar physics issue and launch itself exactly onto the top of the hiders. Man, what a paper.
Wasn't that absolutely unbelievable? No, so with zero guidance, these AI agents were able to come up with strategies that in the first place, no human could have ever imagined. And also, they kept adapting as the opponents changed their strategies. What does all of this mean for investing? How can these capabilities be used to build an advanced investment machine? We know that the world and the markets are in a state of constant flux. Nothing is static. Facts keep changing, which is why our investment strategies also need to be flexible. That is, we need to keep adapting to a changing world in order to stay relevant. Just like these AI agents that we just saw, they were agile enough to adapt every time the opponents changed their approach. Which is why adaptive learning is very critical. You know, the way adaptive learning works is you draw upon your experience to frame a model, which is really your hypothesis, your understanding of how the world works. And this is where experience matters. Now, different people will come up with a different model of the world. And then you experiment with an open mind, like a student, really. Now, you test out as many variations and nuances as are possible. And then you gather the results of your experiments. You analyze them very closely. This is a key step which helps you improve and build upon your prior understanding of the world. And it is this enhanced, improved understanding that you then implement and execute. And obviously, this cycle keeps repeating over and over again. The next aspect is collaboration. Now, just like these AI agents needed to collaborate in order to come up with a winning strategy, similarly, when it comes to investing, multiple aspects need to work together in a very coherent manner. For example, top-down allocation, bottom-up security selection, risk management, responding to real-time events, all of these things need to play their individual roles. And when all of that happens together, that is when you get a winning combination. And these models do a very good job of finding inefficiencies. If you recall from that video, the hiders were quick to realize that the seekers were frozen for a few seconds at the start of the game. It was this realization that allowed them to come up with the strategy of hiding the ramp before the seekers could move. And when the opponents changed their strategy, the hiders adapted to that again, just like the hare. Similarly, in investing, one needs to be vigilant to any inefficiencies that exist and be quick to capitalize on that. Also, if you notice, there were other inefficiencies that were not there by design. The designers of the game had misspecified the physics of the system in a couple of instances. And because of those incorrect specifications, the AI agents were able to surf on those boxes, for example. Also, they were able to launch themselves as projectiles. Now, the designers of the game were human. They had no clue that anyone could even think of these possibilities, which is why these gaps were not plugged by them. They could not even think about it. But the AI agents had no such preconceived notions or any rigid belief systems of what is possible and what isn't possible, which is why they were able to uncover those gaps and exploit those gaps. So we've seen how self-learning works and what is its relevance to investing. At First Global, we've designed and built many such systems. Now, as an example, we'll talk about one such system that relies on the ability to self-learn, which is genetic algorithms and evolutionary computation. This is a family of models that are inspired by nature and by evolution. So we humans, we are the outcome of evolution, a process that has been at work for millions of years. These computational models work in a similar manner over millions of iterations to solve many different problems. Now, this is just like how the AI agents that we just saw learned how to play hide and seek over millions of iterations. So let's define a sample problem. Imagine a universe of 5,000 liquid stocks from across the world, from which we need to build a portfolio, an optimal portfolio of, let's say, 20 stocks. Now, the number of unique 20 stock portfolios that can be created from a 5,000 stock universe is very, very, very large. You know, it's several millions of billions of zillions of possibilities. That is the number you see here on the screen. And by the way, if you consider 30 stock portfolios, the number will be even greater than this. Clearly, we cannot evaluate all the possibilities. Forget a human. This number is you know, too big even for the most advanced supercomputer in the world. So what do? Genetic algorithms have an answer. Just like evolution gave a brilliant design for the human body out of so many other possibilities that could have been. Similarly, genetic algorithms give us a very good portfolio from the space of endless possibilities. The very first principle that genetic algorithms rely on is that of natural selection, which is also known as the survival of the fittest. Consider this example. In an area where there are no low-lying plants and leaves are available only on tree branches, if you have a number of giraffes, only those giraffes that are tall enough to reach the tree leaves will survive. The other ones that do not have that reach will unfortunately die and perish. Now, the ones that do survive, which are the ones which have that tall gene, by the way, will pass on their height onto their children. Meaning that after a few generations, only tall giraffes will be found, the ones who are the best suited to that environment. Natural selection has ensured that the population over time can survive and flourish in its environment. This is exactly how genetic algorithms weed out unhealthy portfolios and retain the fit ones. And of course, the definition of fitness changes as the environment changes. Once natural selection has played its role, next we have crossovers and mutations. You know, a crossover combines two healthy portfolios to generate an offspring, a child portfolio, which combines the best of both the parents. And then mutations keep looking for variations. Think of the mutations as people who are always asking, you know, what if I change this? What if I increase my exposure to emerging markets? What if I add an exotic asset class? Mutations will explore previously unconsidered combinations, and that will lead to out-of-the-box solutions. Selection, crossover, mutation put together completes the cycle. Now, crossovers and mutations keep generating newer possibilities, and selection retains the fit ones. And each cycle gives us one generation of portfolios. And then the cycle is repeated many, many times, churning out a new generation every time. And what happens is each generation of portfolios ends up being slightly better than the previous one, more suited to the environment, more nimble, and more relevant. And by the way, when the environment changes, the portfolios adapt. And that is how genetic algorithms overcome an otherwise insurmountable problem. And this was just one of the many ways how we are using the most advanced tech in investing. And I can go on for hours and hours and talk about many other examples. And we will be doing that in our future webinars. But for now, we will move on to another very fascinating section on First Global's 9 investment mantras. I will hand over to Devina to take you through that. Over to you, Devina.
Thanks, Sachin. And it gets easier to understand from here on for people who would have found this fascinating but a bit complex. So I will be talking about our 9 investment mantras. So it said 8. There is a bonus one. So it's 9 now. And the first one is avoid the big losses, avoid the big drawdowns, which means that even before looking at returns, you must look at risk control. So that is the number one mantra, the overarching mantra. And this is a mantra that we live by. And there is this fascinating article over 40 years old by Charles Ellis that I love and I always say that it is not just eye-opening, it is mind-opening, which is to classify everything into the in the world into a winner's game or a loser's game, depending on whether the outcome is determined by the winner or the loser. I'll explain and how these games evolve. So, for example, if you look at aviation, we know that famous flight of JRD Tata, I think it was 90 years ago or something, when he went from Karachi and there were all these problems on the way, glitches, he had to think on the fly, sometimes not even have the right a spare part with him. So it was an adventure. But today when you fly, you are not looking for flamboyance. You are not looking for adventure. There is only one way to fly today, which is to follow the checklist and make no mistakes. So it's exactly the same in investing. 50, 60 years ago, very few people were looking at stocks. So you could only look for something which nobody else knew about, either in terms of the company or what its characteristics were. But now you have so many people with the same data, very well qualified, very smart people looking at the data. And now there is only one way to play it, which is to avoid the losses. And if you don't lose, you will remain in the game and you will win. So don't get thrown out of the game by making losses. And I'll tell you why this is important, because the percentages are not symmetrical on both sides. If you are at 100 and you lose 35-36%, you need a 50% run up to go back to 100. If you lose 50%, you need to then make 100% to come back to your previous starting point, which is why, you know, this is something that we use, which is buying insurance opportunistically, not all the time, but when we think it is necessary. And you can see that over time, it gives you higher returns. So an unhedged portfolio went from $100 to $408, whereas with this tactical insurance at various points in time, it went up to $465. This is the return. It is also that the drawdowns were lower, the volatility was lower. So this is the first key mantra. The second one comes from the world of gambling in casinos. Be the house, not the gambler. I mean, what do I mean by this? If you look at the casino owners, they have a very small edge in every game. If you look at roulette, for example, you can bet from numbers from 1 to 36, but you can't bet on a zero. So to that extent, there is an advantage to the house, because if the ball falls in 100, nobody wins. So it's a very small advantage. You can say a 1 by 37 advantage that they have. But because there are thousands and millions of games of roulette played, on the average, they know they will make a profit and they do make a profit. So it is the same in investing. When you are investing, you must diversify your skill and play it over a large number of bets. So if, let us say, you or your fund manager is skilled enough to be right, let us say 60 or 65% of the time, because let me tell you, nobody is right 100% of the time. So if you pick only 10 stocks, it may not be that six of them will be winners. It might be only two will be winners or three will be winners. But if you buy 50 stocks and you do have that extra skill, then it is very likely that somewhere close to 30 will be winners. And if you manage your risk on the balance 20, which you are not right on, you will be ahead. So if you have the skill, you have to spread it over a large portfolio to really be sure of consistent returns. So that was the second mantra. The third is that it is horses for courses. Depending on the outlook on the market, you have to look at whether you want to be aggressively positioned and therefore participate in the up markets. When things are looking uncertain, you have to make sure you protect. If you look at last year, that is what happened in February, March, that we were very conservatively positioned from the beginning of March, and we saved investors money, whether by diversifying in other asset classes on a global portfolio or by buying insurance. And then we were well positioned to also participate in the up market when the market moved up. And which is also what our earlier graph showed, that buying insurance is part of that you are trying to protect in the whenever there is uncertainty. And it is not as if that if you buy insurance, every time you will use that insurance, but you are on the side of caution. This is another way to look at it, that every time you don't try to hit the six. In fact, generally, you don't try to hit sixes and get out. In investing, again, being conservative helps. So if even if you feel you're very sure of a stock, let us say, it doesn't mean that you put 20 or 25% of your portfolio in that. Because investing is a game of luck come skill. So looking back, you can always say, oh, I had this great idea. I did so well. And I should have put in more money in that. But that is usually, you know, suffering from a survivorship bias. I mean, for example, I'll tell you, one of our big calls was HDFC Bank in 1996 at a split adjusted price of 3.8 rupees. And you can say that, you know, one should have put 20, 30, 40% of your money in that and how much it would have compounded. And it was a no-brainer to have a private sector bank, etc. But many people forget that there were a whole host of other private sector banks that came at the same time and went out of business. And a person sitting then might have bought those also. Or for that matter, Amazon at $15 in 2001. In hindsight, you can say that you should put in lots of money in something you have high conviction in. But that's not a sensible strategy. Which is why it is great if your returns come from a diversified basket of stocks rather than very, very concentrated. This is play everything, believe nothing. So what does that mean? That means that you can take positions in sectors, in stocks, but don't, and have a hypothesis why they will do well, but don't fall in love with that hypothesis. If you look at FMCG stocks, for instance, you know, you can have a whole hypothesis why these stocks will do well forever. And many people did have that kind of hypothesis. We did buy, for instance, stocks like Nestle at various points in our PMS portfolio, but we did not fall in love with that whole idea of why they will always do well. So also, for example, you know, Chinese stocks. Again, people believe in it and then you get wedded to it, which brings me to the next mantra, which is don't be always bullish, don't be always bearish, be hairish. Why do I say that? Because both bulls and bears are large lumbering animals. They cannot change direction very easily. Now, what is a hare? A hare is small, it is agile, it is fast. Yes, it can run fast in one direction, but it can also change directions very easily. It has a vision of 360 degrees. So it's always alert, looking for signs of change and changing its strategy accordingly. So I was talking of China. If in our global portfolios, we made a lot of money in stocks like Alibaba, Tencent, JD.com, the consumer large tech stocks of China. But then we saw what was happening. At one point, we had over 10-12% in China in our global portfolios. But then there was this issue of Ant Financials, which was an Alibaba affiliate, which had to be pulled at the last minute because of regulatory problems with Chinese government. And we slowly began to see that the Chinese government was trying to clamp down on these majors, basically trying to cut them down to size that they don't become too big for their boots. And we started cutting down on our China exposure, particularly in this area. So just because our hypothesis that they were great winners had been borne out for a period of time did not mean that we could not change direction when the change came. And you know, from that 10-12%, we cut down very aggressively to 3% and then to 2%, and that too mostly non-tech. Things like solar energy and so on. So always be scanning the environment as to what is changing, because as I said, investing is a game of luck and skill. So right up front, know that not all the positions you are taking, not all the bets you are taking will pay off. So don't feel bad if they don't pay off. And the corollary to that is, actually, I think you skipped a slide, Achin. So the next one is that great trades are like buses. You know, this is one of my favorite Richard Branson quotes, that great trades are like buses, and there's always another one coming along. What does that mean? That, you know, very often we get caught up in FOMO, that fear of missing out, that there is a big IPO boom coming, as is the case now in the so-called new age companies. I mentioned the China story. Crypto is another area where I find everybody from college students to retirees saying that we are trading crypto. So every time something like this happens, we have this feeling within us that if we don't get onto this bus, it will leave and we will never be able to make these great returns again. So never be in that mode, because there are always some other opportunity around the corner. So unless you analyze something properly, you have convinced that it is going to work, don't just get caught in that whole bhedchal that everybody is doing it, so I must also do it. But that's a road to major problems, because the statistics show that whenever you try to get onto a bus which is already moving, that is what is already the in sector or the in asset class, you are likely to underperform because you are getting in at the end. And this is what happens often, I mean, incidentally, with many of these thematic mutual funds. If you look at sector funds, whether it is finance sector, whether it was technology earlier or pharmaceuticals, most of them tend to come at when that sector is peaking, because that is where investors think they are going to miss out on this sector and they just want to get in. But that's closer to the end rather than the beginning. That's what the data shows. And the eighth mantra is no storification, just datafication. So what is meant here is that all of us love stories. In fact, that is the one thing that is common again in all human civilizations, from the most sophisticated to the hunter-gatherer, and across time, that humans love stories. They learn through stories. So when you are conveying something to a human being, stories work. So in an ad, a story works, that rather than say that 5 lakh children in this district are malnourished, if you tell the story of one child or one family, that works much better in getting people to contribute to that charity. In investing, when a fund manager tells investors that I have bought this company because it has these great characteristics, management is very good, the consumer brand is very strong, they manage their logistics very well, whatever that story is, it looks very convincing to the investor because the investor is a human being. But the market is not a human being. So the market doesn't care about the best and the most well-crafted stories. So, you know, this is an example of a story that was very popular last year, still remains reasonably popular, that there is a class of companies which will, as stocks, always do well. That they have predictable cash flows, they are great consumer brands, they have great cash flows, et cetera, and they always do well. But as I said, no storification, only datafication. What does the data show? You have Hindustan Lever, which for 11, 12 years from 1999 to 2010 was a big underperformer. So that's the largest in the game. Nestle, 93 to 97, compounded only 2.5% for 4 years. 98 to 02, again, 2.7%. Bata, which is in this category there of this great consumer brand, for 15 years gave 0% return. And the interesting thing is that many of these companies which had these characteristics, so if you had asked somebody 5 years ago, they would have included ITC and Gillette in this list, but they haven't performed, they've given negative returns, so they've quietly been forgotten. So this is what happens with storification, because you are not matching it against what the data really says. And also as a fund manager, once you start telling this story many, many times, in your own mind also, you get more and more convinced and it becomes very difficult to change your mind. And that happens to the best amongst us. I mean, all of us have grown up looking up to Warren Buffett, and his most celebrated investment, I would say, is Coke, which was supposed to have all these characteristics. Again, great brand. It was the number one brand in the world for a very long time. Predictable cash flows, all of that. He bought it. He even made good money on it. But because by telling the story over and over again, he got committed to the story in a sense, and he did not get out. So if you look at it from 1993 to now, 27 years or so, Coke is up only 11 times as against the S&P itself being up 18 times, you know, let alone individual other stocks. So that was not a good place to be in. But because you've told the story, you believe the story, you continued to hold it. And which brings me to the last mantra, which is that rigidity kills. In arteries, we know that is what happens, that if your arteries harden, that's not a good thing for you. And the same thing in investing. And what does that mean? Because things change in investing, whether it is asset classes, whether it is geographies, whether it is sectors, whether there are the investing strategies, let us say, I mean, very broadly, things like value versus growth. There are different times when different things will do well, which is why we often show it, the whole world's investing markets, as a giant wheel, where as something goes up, something else goes down. So it's never the case that everything is going up or everything is going down. But if you are committed to a particular style, a particular type of strategy, that you will buy only a certain type of company, then once one that is out of favor in terms of what the market is doing, then you will be remain caught in the wrong end of the market. So that is important. So with that, I come, you know, I've spoken about it, of course, very briefly. But with that, I come to the end of these investment mantras. And one theme which you would have seen through the investing mantras is that we've spoken more about being cautious, being conservative, managing the risk, because we think all of those things are really the key to having superior returns for your portfolio. And I hand it over to Shankar to explain further how it translates into the real world and how you can evaluate a fund manager's skills based on basically some of these same principles which translate into the numbers. Shankar, over to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it. Right. Okay, Achin, can we go to the next slide? So here is the thing that we all, and you know, we get questions from every investor every single day, literally hundreds, not thousands of them on a weekly, monthly basis. Everybody is focused on only one part, which is the high returns. And we, because we have lots of scars on our back and, you know, gray hairs, because of this decades of investing, because I made my first stock investment in 1982, which is nearly 40 years ago. And because of that early start, one has had the fortune, sometimes misfortune, of having seen all kinds of market cycles. And I can tell you, if I look back and I just had managed to get the wisdom that manage your risk, what Devina talked about, manage the downsides, try and be more consistent in your play rather than shooting for the big sixes, take more singles. You know, I can tell you the net worths, you know, would have been a lot higher, but not just higher, but with a lot less stress, with a lot less blood pressure. So how do you measure blood pressure? And that comes out of measuring consistency. That is why it is so important to marry high returns with consistency. You know, the bad news, of course, is that India has lost 9 innings. I can see it on my left side, but I'll move on to a cricketing analogy right now here. Now, let's take a look at three batsmen, right? Batsman A has consistent scores of 15 every innings in a 5-innings test series. So his average is 50, and because there is no deviation around the average, his standard deviation is 0, right? A batsman B has got the same ending total, which is 250. He also has the same average, which is 50. But because he had four straight zeros and a 250 in the fifth innings, his standard deviation is 100%. And of course, this is a simplified example. Both are simplified, but they're simplified for the reason that, you know, we should just illustrate what consistency actually should mean in a cricketing sense as well as in the investing sense. And then there is a batsman C who's all over the place. You've got a 10, got a 30, got a 5, got an 8, 41. Average is a measly 19. And that comes with a pretty reasonably high standard deviation too. So, you know, you are getting the worst of A and B right here, that you are, you know, really not getting runs, and you're even whatever little you're getting is coming with a reasonably high standard deviation of 14. So here is what we did, and pardon the small print here. I will try and make it, you know, I'll try and explain this a bit. But basically what we did was we ran data for the entire PMS multi-cap universe, okay, which is 60 schemes or 60 managers, right? And we said, and we started from March 2020, because that is when our scheme started. We said we wanted a comparable period so that we can compare, you know, on the time series from when we were born for this particular product and the rest of the industry. So 60 PMS schemes starting date March 1, ending date March 1, 2020, ending date July 31st, 2021, the last complete month of data. And what came out is fairly astonishing. First, what came out is that the best performing schemes in terms of consistency were a very, very measly number, which was just 7%. 7%. Which was about roughly four PMS schemes in out of 60, beat the market on 65% of the months. So 17 months, only four PMS schemes beat the market consistently. Consistency is defined obviously as a number of roughly two-thirds. Because nobody, as Devina also mentioned, that nobody in this world, not even God managing money, can beat the market 100% of the time. That's not going to happen. Right? So let's exclude that. The next best is going to be a roughly two-thirds chance of beating the market on a consistent basis. Only four schemes got there out of 60. That's just 7%. The rest of the schemes were beating the market, you know, half the time and far less also. So the tallest tower you see is on the extreme right. That basically 92% of the PMS beat the market 35% of the months, and 97% of the PMSs beat the market just 29% of the months. That means out of 17 months, you're talking, you know, the clustering was 4 months or 5 months. That means vast majority of, if you take each month as an innings, that means you had poor scores in virtually, you know, 30% of the innings, 50% of the innings, 70% of the innings, 80% of the innings. I mean, that's the kind of poverty of consistency you see across the PMS industry. And of course, if we did that for mutual fund, we would definitely find a similar pattern emerging. What this means is that most of the players in PMS are basically either batsman B or they are batsman C. There is only a handful which is belonging to batsman A category, which is consistent returns across each innings or most of the innings through the entire period in question. And that itself is an eye-opening piece of data, that everybody talks of the way they perform as if they are batsman A, but the data shows that you are either batsman B, which means that you may have had two or three, four very good months, and then the balance of the periods are very, very mediocre. So ending return, if you remember, for batsman B was 250 runs, which was identical to batsman A. Average was also 50, same as that of batsman A, but the standard deviation of returns was like, you know, 100x of batsman A, which means that your returns were coming and your runs were coming from a very narrow list of periods. So one innings gave you most of the returns for that batsman. There are literally dozens of PMSs. Whatever returns they are making are also coming from a very, very narrow list of periods, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months. So true hallmark of a great batsman is how consistently he bats. It's not just the ending series total, or it's not only the average. Those are important measures. But how you arrived there is equally important, because how you arrived there means people have more confidence in you. When Sunil Gavaskar went out to bat, we knew with reasonable certainty what he would deliver. When Rahul Dravid went out to bat, we knew with reasonable certainty what he would deliver. When Sehwag went out to bat, we had no idea. So the point is that it's great to have those players, but you don't want to bet on mercurial players to save you through a whole lifetime of test cricket. The same in fund management. So if I move on to the next slide, which further, you know, explores this, we have a ratio which we have popularized in the last few months called the gain to pain, which is another look at what is the kind of return quality that a PMS fund manager is delivering. And let me just give you a live example of our own PMS scheme returns to tell you how we calculate it. In a very simplified sense, the numerator of the gain, which is the numerator, is basically the total gains achieved in a certain period. So if you look at our own PMS returns for the entire period, the sum total was 74, or say 75%. And we had a few losing months. So March was a losing month for us, obviously, March 2020, where we were down 7.7%. Of course, the markets were down a lot more. You know, we did, you know, better, but still there were scars. It's not that you escaped with no losses. Then May was a negative. Then October was a small negative. Otherwise, we've had largely positive months. So out of 17 months, we've had 3 down months. So the total of the 3 down months comes to 14.38%. So 75% divided by 14.38% is 5.21. That is the gain to pain ratio, which is a very simple, intuitive, non-statistical jargon-based measure to conclude for any manager, any PMS manager, how much returns they are delivering with how much pain they're making you endure. And in our case, you know, there was some pain. You cannot have gains without pains, but it was relatively a fairly decent ratio. And I will show you on the next slide what the industry ratios are. A lot of data here. Let me just cut through to the chase. So, and this, we always, and across all our communications, Twitter, wherever you will hear is that us, is that we are endlessly in this, to expound that investing is a combination of luck and skill, but there are methods to minimize the role of luck and maximize the role of skill. Traditional investing, the way it is practiced, is largely luck, which is marketed as skill. And this data that is right here on the screen tells you what is the difference between luck and skill. Skill means high return, yet with consistency, low volatility, and high gain to pain. That is the meaning of skill. Now, if you had the same, remember batsman B, if you had the same 250, but all of it came from a single innings, that was luck, or at least largely. It's not that you can be an idiot and make 250, you still needed some skill, but it was largely luck that made that happen. Because if you were that skillful, you should not have been making 4 zeros in a row. So this data exactly puts it in the context of the PMS industry. If you see our returns calendar year, this year are nearly 45%. The next best is 34, and then White Oak is 24. So basically we are like roughly twice as good as most players, and in fact, 3 times as good as many players down at the bottom. But that's not the only reason why we are putting this slide up. I mean, like I said, you can swing a bat and get 250 runs. That's batsman B. The real test is in the gain to pain, which is towards the right. 5.2 for us, as I mentioned, 2.25 for the next, 2 for the next. And then you can see it just keeps collapsing down to under 1 and around 1.25, which means that ultimately you are getting any whatever return somebody is delivering to you are coming with an equal dose of pain. So your gains are equal to your pain. What is the purpose of doing anything where your gain is equal to your pain? You need some delta over your pain. Otherwise, there is no fun in doing this. But the gain to pain is so stark and so actually fairly shocking, to say the least, that this is what the industry stacks up again. Now, the other important aspect is that you can see at number 5 is Nifty 500 and number 9 is Nifty 50. So just 4 funds have managed to beat the broad market in the last 17 months. Most people actually have lagged the market. So that is the other important thing here. Now, the other point is after gain to pain, that so you got high returns, you need lower volatility. You can see our volatility is the risk adjusted returns, you know, which is embedded. The vol is embedded is, of course, you know, pretty good, twice that of the next. But that lavender colored column and the next one, the orange colored column, is exactly what I had displayed a few minutes back. It shows the number of outperforming months in this entire period. So we had, out of the 17-month period, we had 11 outperforming months. The next two best are 10. And then it dwindles down. You can keep seeing that, you know, you have 8, you have 6, you have 7, 8, 6, 5, which is like, you know, down. If you look at percentage of the same data, we beat the market on 65% of the occasions in the last 17 months. And then the data starts to collapse. So you have a 35%, you have 47%, you have 259%, which is decent, then 41%. So less than a toss of coin, basically. Anything less than 50% is basically less than a toss of coin. And then you're down to 41%, 47%. I mean, 35%. That is telling you that even if whatever returns they got, so let's look at a 35%er. Okay. So without taking any names, let's say a 35%er delivered you 28% return, which is the first column. But it came bunched. Most of it basically came bunched in a few months. The other months were pain-giving months. You beat the market on very few occasions. So it is poor quality returns. It is not consistent returns. What you want are high returns, but with consistency. Ashin, can you go to the next slide? This is the same or similar data, just in a time series format. The green line is us. And then we have a peer group in the multi-cap segment. These are the same players who were there on the, most of the same players who were there on the preceding table, which is basically you have Marcellus, you have ASK, Motilal, IFL, Girik, Alchemy, ASK, Ambit, Coffee Can, everybody. Again, the point is that all this is not coming out of some magic, or it's not coming out of some strange alchemy. This comes, these numbers, these results, this data comes out of a slavish devotion to process, data. I cannot overstress it enough that this is not coming out of some strange genius. It is coming out of bottling that experience into a self-learning system, which Achin described at the beginning, which keeps evolving, keeps mutating into newer and newer angles that maybe we individually would never have been able to connect all the dots to arrive at. This is my final slide. So if you put everything together, and you must have seen movies in which you create a perfect athlete or a perfect boxer or a perfect bodybuilder, what should go into it if you have to engineer such a fund manager? So obviously, you know, we want to define what is a perfect fund manager, a perfect PMS fund manager. You need high returns. We all know that. I mean, decently high, very, very high returns like Bernie Madoff also should make you vary, but decently high returns. You obviously want a high gain to pain ratio. You obviously want a low volatility return profile. You want those high percentage of winning periods. You don't want the returns to be coming from a very narrow list of periods, which means that 3 months contributed all your gains. Or also, you don't want those returns coming from a narrow list of stocks, which Devina mentioned in one of the 9 investing mantras of FG, that your returns should come from a wider range of stocks rather than a narrower range of stocks for you to qualify to be called as a skillful fund manager. So consistency of returns over periods and over number of stocks you definitely desire. And the final point, again, Devina has mentioned this, but I need to mention this, that the worst blunders I made in my life is when I forgot the principle of risk management. So you want a fund manager with high returns, high gain to pain, low volatility, consistent returns, and very, very stringent risk management. And you put that in a Venn diagram and you go and pick the fund manager which falls into the center shaded area. And since it is our webinar, we have to put our name in there, but you might find one or two. But I'm not going to be modest. These numbers are pure data. They're available on the SEBI website. In the center part of the Venn diagram is us. Again, I mentioned this is not coming out of any individual genius here. It comes out of putting every piece of experience into a codified form, which then self-learns and improves even what we might have improved ourselves as individual managers. With that, I close the presentation and we'll be delighted to take questions.
Sure, we have received it's a very, very long list of questions that we've received. I'll try to put in as many as we can. So I'll start off with, I think, one of the most popular questions that we've received thus far. People are asking that we've spoken about PMS schemes. Do we have anything for the smaller investors at all?
Yes. I will answer that. That's a good question. In fact, on Twitter also, we have received a number of such queries. We are just about to... So by the way, we used to have a very popular product called the Self-Drive Portfolio Baskets last year. We still continue, but we stopped taking new money because there were some logistical challenges in execution. But now we are relaunching the same product on our own website. Our website is firstglobalsec.com. And you can email us on info@firstglobalsec.com for information on any of our products, PMS, Global Investing, as well as the small investor product. So we are launching the Self-Drive Portfolio Basket on our own platform as well as on Smallcase. And hopefully we should be live in the next few weeks' time, which will enable even the smallest investors in India to participate in the tech that we are using to really make the whole investing process a very, very scientific one. So yes, the answer is yes, Achin. We will be launching a small investor product, 2 weeks time, I think?
Yeah, roughly 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay, great. But please send us an email on info@firstglobalsec.com, firstglobalsec, firstglobalsec.com. And we will log you into our database so that we'll shoot you an email the moment we are live with it.
Okay, let me just add to that of course, for the PMS, we all know that the SEBI minimum is 50 lakhs. It can be only in the equity product or the equity cum multi-asset product we have. But for our global portfolios, the starting point is $10,000. So that's roughly about 7.5 lakh rupees. So with that, you get a product which actually, in its consideration set, has all asset classes, all geographies. And even internationally, there is no product available which gives you that wide a variety at such a low entry point. I mean, below $1 million, you can't even think of accessing that in normal circumstances. So that's the other product which is available for investors who are looking to invest less than 50 lakhs.
Sure. Yeah, another question that a lot of people have asked is, given that the markets have run up a bit by now, so should they invest or should they wait for a correction before entering?
Right. So if I got a dollar for each time I've been asked this question, I would be richer by at least $1 million. in the last 6 months' time. So the answer is, in our view, and this is again based on data, none of what we say is ever based on opinion. Opinion, they should have an opinion, but it should be based on data. Data tells us this, that whenever a market undergoes a period of very, very poor returns, just as India, like for example, India endured from 2008 January up until say the March of 2020, March of 2020, the Sensex fell to 27,000. It was 21,000 nearly, 12 years back in January of 2008. It was 21,000. So over a journey of 12 years, it had returned virtually nothing from 21 to 28, 27,000 in 12 years. I don't know what it comes to, maybe a couple of percent. So obviously India has been or had been a very disappointing market for investors. We know even FD returns could not have, get made for this period. But that has changed in the last 12 months' time. And therefore, we should not start to believe and believe wrongly that it is enough and a lot has happened. Obviously, there will be corrections. It probably is due right now. But this bull market is not stopping anytime soon. It is still just at the very infancy of the next wave of bull market. The previous bull market ended in January 2008. After that, it has been a broad bear market, relative bear market for 12 long years. 12 long years ke ye samajh lijiye banvas ke baad market has come back. It is not going back into banvas anytime soon.
All right. A couple of people have asked whether the performance that was mentioned on the slides, are those post-fees performance?
Yes, I do believe every single thing we report has to be post-fees as per SEBI law itself. So every single thing we report has to be and is mandatorily after fees. Sure. I must also add one thing here, and Achin, it's relevant for us to point out that that we as managers are not the cheapest fund managers in the industry. And we have no desire to be the cheapest fund manager in the industry. And I will say this with all emphasis that in matters of wealth and in matters of health, that if the Fed, if the Fed wants to raise rates, it would raise rates only if inflation becomes, instead of being transitory, becomes more stubborn. And the reason why inflation might become stubborn is because of high and trending higher commodity prices, which definitely is something that the Fed will not like. And therefore, what might happen to derail a commodity bull market, which can ignite inflation? Well, the way to crush it is to rally the dollar. And the dollar did start to rally, as you've seen in the last couple of months. And that was enough trigger for us to take money off the table in commodities. It's not to say that commodity run is over, but it is simply that to expect oil will be 150 is a very, very unlikely scenario, or steel to continue making such super normal profits. And now Tata Steel and ArcelorMittal are now all, I think single digit PE multiples. And the time to buy all these companies, steel companies, is when their PE multiples are infinite, which means they're loss-making companies. And you sell them when their PE multiples are very low, which is 7, 6, 7, 8 PE multiples. That's been the mantra to follow in commodity stock investing. So buy at high PE multiples, sell at low PE multiples. So now PE multiples are low. We took money off the table. China is cracking down. Iron ore prices have really crashed. So there is at least not huge upside. There might be a bit, but not a lot.
All right. On a related note, sticking to the realm of market views, a lot of people want to know your views on the mid and the small cap space in India.
That's a good space. So, again, good meaning you have to play them wisely. Don't go all out. As Devina mentioned, we have barely 10% at the really small cap end. Of the market, because there are very hard exits in these stocks. It is very, very hard to exit. People have forgotten very quickly how good 2017 was when the small cap market, I think, rallied 70% or so. But how terrible 2018 was, and in fact, even 2019 was very terrible, because you got stuck into position. There were no exits. You know, again, scars on the back tell us, be conservative here. Please participate, but participate with caution, which is exactly what we are doing. There is still room left for small caps to run, because low interest rates mean only one thing, that the riskiest ends of the market will do well, which means small caps are the riskiest end. Venture capital is the riskiest end. And you can see the big bull market in venture capital funding when all kinds of companies with no fundamental get a $1 billion valuation. You know, till the Fed remains here, you know, I don't see a major problem in small caps. But again, please be cautious.
All right. I know you've spoken about portfolio insurance in a fair bit of detail, but we have a lot of people asking, how exactly is insurance purchased? Is it through derivatives? Is that allowed? So just a bit more specifics on that would be really helpful.
Sure. Yeah. So in our India PMS, in India PMS regulations allow hedging. AIF regulation obviously allow hedging and more than that. You know, so they are absolutely allowed and one can do that. Remember, and of course, on the global side, on a global fund, we take periodic opportunistic portfolio insurance. We do. So let me explain. So you can insure your portfolio, one, through derivatives, second, through different asset classes. So if you have 100% equity exposure, you may at tactical points want to put some fixed income into it, just as we did in February, March last year. So that at least if the danger just come to pass, you have not exposed yourself to 100% equity risk. So that is one way. Derivatives are obviously the way. But each of them has to be done opportunistically. For example, if you keep buying put options all the time, then you will end up spending like anything between 5 to 10% per year on buying insurance. And in a normal year, markets might return you 20%. That means half your returns have gone in insurance, which is a lot to pay for insurance. Okay, so there is a good price to pay. There is a bad price to pay for everything, including insurance. So it has to be done opportunistically. And again, the systems that we have built and are building at FG tell our AI bots, you know, they are self-learning. So they tell us when it is wise to buy insurance and they keep improving. So they are not 100% perfect, but they will get there. I can tell you they can get there much better than we will individually do. So portfolio insurance, in short, you can buy put options, but buy them opportunistically. Don't just blindly buy them at all times. Otherwise, the cost will more than eat away the returns that you might make.
Okay. For the next question, the person who's asked the question has specifically requested that he wants both of you to respond. So the question is, whose thought process influenced you the most as a child or as a teen?
Okay, so the child or the teen, I don't know whether that would be very relevant in terms of any person who influenced. But I will tell you what has not changed since I was a child. And that is that for me, learning is the most important thing in my life. So that is something that gives me the most thrill, the most fun, the most satisfaction. And that has not changed. That has remained consistent. So investing is a field where you are constantly learning. Even 30 plus years after I went into this, I'm still learning. So, you know, long past those 10,000 hours of work and reading books and reading various people. And in investing or in, you know, you talked about being influenced by someone. You have to read everybody, but don't take anyone at face value. So, you know, you don't say that so-and-so is my hero and or heroine and I'm going to follow them. So read what everybody has to say, evaluate, get the skill to evaluate and then formulate your own philosophy. But that input also has to be there. So, I mean, there is no getting around the reading and learning. And as I said, to me, that is the most fun part. And many times on this journey, you will have to change or go away from your comfort zone. I'll give you a couple of examples. You know, one was that you were happily following Indian companies in the 90s. And then at the end of the 90s, we made that decision to go global. I decided we wanted to go to the biggest markets in the world. So you had to relearn so many things of looking at macros in the world market, looking at companies which were much more complex than Indian markets. Then again, that move from a human model of fund management to a human plus machine model that we are following now. Again, you know, changing your comfort zone, learning something new, because that was giving better results. So investing is a process of constant learning, constant evolution. So if that makes you happy, this is the right place to be. If not, then there's a issue. And related to that, you know, some of the things we spoke about, like storification, etc., besides the concrete tools of investing in learning finance, what ratios to use, how to read markets, you also have to learn about how your mind works, because investing is also really about how you think, how you make decisions. So what are the fallacies in your thinking, which is, you know, some of the books which I recommend for that, like Thinking Fast and Slow, Invisible Gorilla, Halo Effect, Richard Thaler's work, which is over and above the investment tomes, which is, you know, this is really about also understanding your own thinking and to make sure how that doesn't derail your investment journey. So I hope it gives you some insights. And over to you, Shankar.
What was the question, Achin? I forgot.
So they want to know whose thought process influenced you the most as a child or a teen.
Okay, great. Yeah. So, I mean, even as a kid, you know, I was a very precocious child. So I was up to no good most of the time. My school principal, Father Hess, who was an American priest, and he was a brilliant scientist, you know, physics, scientist, and all our missionaries were really big science fanatics. Father Kirsch, who taught us physics, was also, I think, in line to become a, you know, Nobel laureate. So I was really very, very fortunate to have been educated by great scientists as a kid. And they taught us at least taught me the value of questioning belief systems. I mean, and that, and my father, who was also a big, influence, taught me that, you know, you must question things and, you know, just don't become lakir ka fakir, you know, try and do things which are unconventional. So he told me in class 4 that you're too sida, you know, you should become a gunda. Go and pick up some fights. I want to get some complaint from your teacher that I'm not getting enough feedback. So you're doing good in studies, but that's not good enough. So he told me ki life mein aage badhna hai beta to thoda gundagardi bhi karo. So I took it to heart. So, you know, I've been exposed to that. And then one book I read in my first year of MBA, practically, I think the very first month of MBA, when the guy who was the most brilliant guy in our batch, Marvin, is really a very bright guy, a real dear friend till this day, he told me that, you must read this book. This book called The Mind of the Strategist from Japanese author called Kenichi Omai. And that just changed my thinking so much. I mean, as it is, I'm a non-believer, I'm a questioner. But that book itself was all about that. And how a mind of a strategist always questions things, never assumes anything, never takes easy answers. And after that, every single case study I did in my MBA, I would write on the very front page. And then on every subsequent page, and these were big cases, 30, 40, 50, 200 page cases, that question every assumption. It's exactly what the AI bots are doing. That's exactly what those guys, those little creatures were doing in the video that Achin shared, that they just question the assumption that why does this sofa need to be there? Why can I not use it as a ramp to jump off instead of just sitting? Most of us will think the sofa is meant for sitting, right? So just questioning beliefs has been very central to my overall education and journey. And I think any forget investing in anything you do, don't just, you know, assume anything that no matter who it is being said from, you know, just question everything. You will find amazing insights coming if you're just a questioner instead of being a believer.
Sure. That's very interesting and very useful. The next question is, people are asking for someone who has a long-term investment horizon, let's say 10, 15, 20 years. Are there any particular sectors that you can recommend, or any stocks that you'd like to recommend for that horizon?
So, I mean, again, you should have there are two parts of the question that you should, first of all, you have a long-term horizon. I don't think you should ever enter investing with a short-term horizon. So that's the first answer. You should have a long-term horizon. That is one. Now, that is exactly what the problem I was talking about, that when you start to form opinions 10 years in advance, you are inevitably, in not all the time, but in reasonable proportion, be wrong, because the world changes too fast. You have a hypothesis. Based on that hypothesis, you should allocate some capital. As of right now, we know clean energy is going to be huge. We just know it, right? You know that the world is going to be moving towards zero emissions, and you know all kinds of clean energy tech will do well, provided they are able to produce and sell their goods and services at a viable price. Therefore, that's a great area to be in. If you can find plays which give us exposure, we should be there. But to say that we will bet, make a big bet, all or nothing bet on that 60% of portfolio, that is going to be foolish. Because even that sector will mutate. It will keep changing. Newer things will come, which will make the previous generation of clean tech become obsolete. Allocate capital, but not so much that you can get wiped out.
All right.
And you don't even know, I mean, just to add to that, even in that sector, you will not know who will be the eventual winners. And the world is moving faster and faster. You know, that is one clear takeaway from data. Even I was looking at the data for the S&P 500. In the 1960s and 70s, the average age of the stock in the portfolio or in the index used to be 50, 60 years. By 2015, it was down to 18 years. Now it's down even lower. And I just also give this example that when we started following US companies around year 2000, the tech majors used to be IBM, Dell, Cisco. All of them are no longer, when you talk of tech majors, they no longer feature. It's only Microsoft from that era, which is still among the majors. So it is, you cannot buy and forget a stock for 10 years in most cases. And as I said, most of the time when you look at that, you don't look at the other stocks from that era, which did not survive. So which is why we say that you have to keep looking at your portfolio on a dynamic and tactical basis. And Achin, I think there was one question right at the beginning, even I think before the seminar started, which is why probably you might have missed out. It said that we are talking of artificial intelligence and machine learning, but how come some quant hedge funds go bust? And to that, I would like Achin also to add to that. But I mean, what I would like to say is that all of these things are just tools. They are not magic keys. AI ML is a tool, just as an Excel sheet is a tool. You can understand that I know Excel, you know Excel, doesn't mean the financial model we make for a company will be the same. That is just a tool. So it depends on what is going into that, what expertise is getting coded, and how rigorously also you are making that model. There are a whole range of things, and I'll hand it over to Achin to explain a little more.
Yeah, I mean, I could not have put that across any better. Like you said, at the end of the day, it all depends on how you are using those tools. So saying that, why are these other quant funds failing? It's like saying, why are these human funds failing? Just like any two human managed funds are very, very different based on what goes into the decision making. Similarly, any two funds that rely on machines or quants or these models, there's no similarity at all, apart from the fact that they're using some algorithms, right? It all depends on what goes into those systems, which is where years of experience, expertise, and skill come into the picture.
And the ability to constantly question yourself. Absolutely. You know, there is nothing that we do, that we assume, is like now we are, it's done. There is, everything is WIP. We are never resting. We are always restlessly, you know, looking to improve things, which is exactly what a good human manager should be doing as well. I mean, there is no difference in that sense.
I think there are a lot of questions. I'll just wrap up with just two or three more questions. And this is on the last section of the presentation where we were measuring TMS performance. So a question that has come up is, why is that performance is being measured on a monthly basis? For example, why are we calculating gain to pain on a monthly basis? Why not on a daily basis?
Because that is the data availability.
Yeah.
So there is, so, you know, we cannot get for the entire universe. We know our daily data, but we don't get daily data for every single PMS out there. The only discrete periods you get are monthly data. And that is why we measure monthly. If you were to get it, you should measure it, but you should not rely too much on daily numbers because that will be all over the place. That will be, that is a classical reductio ad absurdum, which is that we can take an argument to its absurdity. So taking it to a daily measurement and then even down to intraday is all really, that's not necessary. But a month is a decent period in which you should measure performance, as long as you have many months over which you are measuring. So we have 17 months of data now, which is a pretty decent amount of months on which we are measuring the gain to pain as well as the consistency of returns.
I know you spoke at length about the gain to pain ratio. Can you just briefly touch upon the CAGR to volatility, the risk adjusted return, in a bit more detail, how that helps us?
Right. So CAGR is CAGR. We know, you know, over a period of time, what is the compound annual growth rate of a fund? That is easy to calculate. There's no big deal there. Volatility is nothing but standard deviation, which we mentioned, you know, illustrated through the use of cricket, that you have batsman A and batsman B. Batsman A had 50s in every innings and batsman B had a single big score of 250 preceded by continuous zeros. So the batsman B standard deviation, his mean was 50, but the deviation, which is volatility around the mean, was 100%, right? Which means that he was not even getting to the mean on most of the equations. In fact, on all the occasions, while batsman A was hitting the mean of 50 in every single innings. So he had no volatility around his mean, which is exactly the way you look at a fund. So CAGR to volatility, CAGR is your return over a period. So, you know, that's a compounded return divided by the standard deviation. Standard deviation for a fund is again measured in exactly the same way. That you take the monthly returns and you see the volatility also. You have an average for the period and you see the volatility around the average. Lower the volatility number. If somebody has delivered, let's say, returns of 20% with a standard deviation, which is volatility of 10, that means the Sharpe ratio or the return by vol is 2. And obviously, somebody has delivered 50% with the same vol of 10% has got a ratio of 5. So the higher the ratio, the better it is. The difference between this ratio and the gain to pain is important to understand. And I just want to take a minute to explain. Volatility means good volatility and bad volatility, which means up volatility and down volatility, right? Because it is measuring it on both sides of the mean. So you have the Sortino, which measures only downside volatility. But we are not going there. There are many other measures, you know, which we didn't want to complicate the message. But gain to pain is something that you yourself sitting in your living room with no knowledge of statistics, you can do this. There is, as long as the data is there and a monthly data is available for every PMS, every mutual fund, this data is freely available. You don't need any other thing, you know, just the data download from their websites. Put them into your Excel or even on a normal handheld, you know, calculator on your mobile phone, and you'll have the gain to pain ratio right there in front of you. How much gain did somebody deliver for how much pain they made you endure? We have given the formula there. If you have any confusion, please email us on info@firstglobalsec.com and we'll be happy to clarify that.
Sure. I think some people did not get the email address the first time and they're saying that they're not able to send out an email. So just to repeat, just to clarify,
it's can you just write it out? Is it possible to
yeah, what? Can you put it on the screen? That would be best.
Sure.
Yeah, yeah, both the website and the email, both, so that people can just take a screenshot.
Yes. So this is the website, www.firstglobalsec.com, and the email address is info@firstglobalsec.com.
Can you make it bigger so that people can
see? Yeah, just make it bigger and bold. Yeah. Right. I hope people can see it now.
Right. So one final question. One final question before we wrap it up for the evening. So we have a lot of people who are keenly interested in self-learning. So any recommendations, any books that you think people wanting to become better investors should read?
So Devina, you should post it. Achin, perhaps you can type it out as Devina tells you. That would be useful.
Yeah, actually, we have a whole blog written on the categories of books that you can read. We can, whoever is interested, we can, I'll also share it on my Twitter, the blog. The books that I mentioned just now, I can tell you those are Thinking Fast and Slow. There is The Halo Effect. There is Misbehaving by Richard Thaler. And The Invisible Gorilla. These are the ones that I mentioned. But there are like whole categories of books, right from actual investment books to business biographies. So that blog covers the categories you can look at.
And then, of course, you know, the if you want to really become a consummate investor, you must learn all the tools of the trade. So you must know fundamental analysis inside out, which you must know through proper hard core theory of fundamental analysis and corporate finance. Don't just think, you know, P ratio and all is just enough in this, just to that, you know, you have to go a little deeper into the game of corporate finance itself, from which investing comes out. Then you should look at technical analysis. You should look at quantitative research. You should look at macroeconomics. Again, in each category, you will find, if you go to Amazon, do a search, you will find five very good books on each of these subjects. That's a good start. Buy 100 books. I mean, I was telling somebody the other day on a podcast that back in the 90s, when our income itself was nothing worth writing home about in the early 90s, Devina and I had a target, monthly target of spending 10,000 rupees per month on books. So, you know, whether we would go out for dinner or not is irrelevant, but 10,000 rupees per month we would spend, you know, religiously every weekend, go out there to Strand Bookstall or to Sterling Bookshop, which was like a, you know, treasure trove for finance books, and buy up, you know, really expensive books, 1,000 rupee books, 2,000 rupee books, and come back and have a great weekend reading through them. So you need to dive deep. There is no shortcut to really learning this game.
Sure, I think with that, we will have to call it a day. There were a lot of other questions. I wish I could have taken more, but yeah, I think we need to respect the time.
Sure. Thank you, Achin. Thank you, Devina. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for attending.
Yes. Thanks, everyone, for being here. And you can always contact us on through the email, on Twitter, whatever suits you.
Thank you very
so much, everyone.
Have a great weekend. Bye. Thank you.